Hey everybody, welcome to the Quad Spot, your spot for the next generation of YouTube. I'm Randy.
I'm Steve.
And I'm Toden.
And we have with us a very special guest. You know him as Uncle Nalty or Nalty. And it's Kevin Nalty. Welcome, Kevin.
Thrilled to be here. And I love the intro porn music.
Oh, yeah.
It's fantastic, isn't it? Now, for those people who are new to YouTube, because most of the older YouTubers know who Nalty is, can you just give a little history of your channel?
Yeah, sure. I started, you know, about a year into YouTube, and so it's been 5 or 6 years. So I'm one of the old school guard, and or the original viral video genius, as I like to call myself.
There you go.
But I'm definitely not the best creator online, definitely not the best marketer, but I'm one of the few people that sort of combine those two. And so I've got about 1,000 videos, mostly sophomoric pranks and that kind of thing.
Awesome.
Yeah, rumor has it you will video for food.
I will. Well, that was the whole essence of that blog was because at the time, very few people were making any money. And so I thought, wouldn't it be fun to write a blog and get a community going around people that enjoy the social aspects of it, but also, you know, are kind of looking for a side income.
Summary, Will Video for Food is a blog.
That's right. That's right.
For those that don't know.
What got you into YouTube, Kevin?
Well, what got me in, to be transparent, was that I thought it would be a good way to share online videos, grow an audience, and ultimately make money. But I was posting for a while on Revver.com, which was a website that shared advertising income with creators. And then it wasn't for years until YouTube did, which I'm kind of glad about, because then I started to discover a much more rewarding part of YouTube, which is sort of the community and the cross-collaboration and meeting people that I would otherwise never meet, and sharing, you know, something we had in common, which is sort of, you know, creativity. And then after a while, of course, you do start to make money on it. But I found that the community aspect was way more rewarding than the money. Mm-hmm.
Right. Now, like we said, you're big on YouTube, and I just want to, I kind of want to cut some of the background in, because I think people should just go check out your channel, and I want to talk about a little more about the community. I mean, you are, you know, for a while, you were really into the community. Tell us some things that you've done.
Yeah, so, I mean, I probably lapsed in the recent years or so, just being busy with kids and the marketing profession. But I was sort of part of the initial groundswell to create live events. And so one of our first major gatherings was 777 in New York, where we got to pull a bunch of people together. And at that time, you know, it wasn't like VidCon, people on stage and some people in the audience. It was just a real egalitarian collection of people. Some were, you know, some went on to become really, really big YouTubers, and others are just avid, you know, community members or viewers. Mm-hmm. And so that led to a whole bunch of different grassroots gatherings, and I've probably done, I don't know, a couple dozen meetups, which are really fun because you get to meet the people, see them up close, poke them, literally poke them. You have to bleep that out.
No.
You know, for those viewing or listening, there is a person dedicated to this staff just to write down keywords that can be used in the description. So if I might add poke, Justin Bieber, and mesothelioma to that list.
Now, do you think the community has changed a lot since you've started? Like, I've noticed that it's actually in the last couple of years, the community has pretty much changed a lot. Do you think it's going for the worse or the bad?
I think it's getting better. I think there's an original core group of people that are still very active, but I do think that the money aspect, I mean, if you want to destroy a, you know, community, introduce, you know, monetary system, I think that sort of created a weird dynamic where some people were popular, some weren't, some were making money and some weren't. But I think if you cut out the sort of, you know, people that graze YouTube or that know maybe a few creators, and you get to the core people that, you know, those of us sort of live in YouTube, I think that community does still exist. I think that the YouTube gatherings, though, as an example, have sort of changed a little bit. Mm-hmm. And that's too bad. But I think some of the local meetups that are less formal are just, you know, in the same spirits as the 777 and earlier gatherings.
Now, you mentioned money. Do you think in the most recent year that YouTubers are upping their game a little bit when it comes to microphones, sets, and, you know, What do you think about that?
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm guilty of, you know, there are a lot of psychological theories that if you are innately drawn to something and then you're compensated for it, you lose that sort of innate draw. And it mm-hmm. sounds paradoxical, but if you have a hobby that you love and you start to get compensated for the hobby, your actually desire to do that is diminished. And I think that sort of happened to me on YouTube. But yeah, so I think what happened was once money got introduced, everybody felt they had to up the game. And I definitely have always said the production standards are not the big driver of video. My worst videos are the ones that are highly produced and edited and scripted, and they almost are guaranteed not to get views. And the stuff that are just spontaneous and feel natural and are, you know, real people in real situations with a flip cam and no good lighting, you know, those tend to get more views.
Like you in the car driving?
Yeah, I mean, those driving vlogs. I mean, I think that's what people kind of turn to online video for. And I think one of the challenges YouTube's got is now with all the sort of more serious production coming, you know, how do we not lose that sort of, you know, amateur, you know, where we can look at a viewer and say, yeah, that's me, and feel like they're being authentic and you know, real.
The broadcast yourself aspect.
Right. Yeah, as opposed to, you know, I mean, sometimes I see some of the people I know and love that once they're high, I mean, like Shay Carl's a great example. I love Shay Carl when it was like watching an old episode of The Three Stooges, like poorly edited jump cuts, awkward pauses, shitty audio. And then you see them all decked out in lighting with a boom mic and everything. And you're like, oh, come on, that's not Shay.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I've noticed a lot of the older YouTubers that I used to watch like 2 years ago, 3 years ago, now they're just like, their production is so much. It's just elaborate now. It's like they've got people that edit for them, like Shay Carl. I mean, it's like, gosh, this is just a hobby. It's just a, you know, it's like, when can I get that good to where I could do that, you know? And it's like,
yeah, I think it's overrated, though. I mean, I think like what I love about video, part of the original motivation for me is I work in marketing, and everything I do has to go through a committee. So I love like going home at night and just having my own video, my own editing. I could do whatever I wanted. It was usually one man show. And then as you lose that, you know, I think it becomes less interesting. I really hands on. Like I could see bringing people in to help with the lighting and the production, but there's something about editing. I just
the
can't
editing is important. Yeah. I like doing my own editing when I do, you know.
Yeah.
It's nice to be the last person to say your name before it goes out.
Right. You know, to your point, I was in a corporate video recently for the day job, and they did their own cut. And it was such a helpless feeling to get up there and be interviewed and then just wait until the video is released and hope that they didn't choose the shittiest possible soundbite ever.
Because you don't know the editor that well, you know, it's like...
I slept him a 20 just in case, but he still made my head look like it was like 300 pounds.
Nobody's ever slept me a 20.
I don't have my wallet right here, but I can take care of that.
Well, I mean, I did do your eulogy once for a class.
My eulogy?
Yes, I did a video doing a eulogy about you dying in a car accident, and I was in front of the class when I did it. I mean, I figured it'd be a lesson. You shouldn't vlog while you're driving. But.
You know, somebody just from a safety association just asked if they could use a video parody I did where I was texting, emailing, you know, and it was just a whole spoof, exaggerated spoof. But for the longest time, when people would criticize me for making a video vlog, I would in the comments write, it's a green screen, and they would believe it.
Nice.
Yeah, I think I was commenting on one video and someone said that. I was like, you shouldn't drive in the car, or you shouldn't vlog in the car. And someone said, it's a green screen.
Oh, they jumped in at it. Yeah, so after a while, people started to...
It was funny. I was like, oh my God. I think it was actually Jason that actually said that.
I did do a video that showed how we did it. And I showed my kids coming out. And I said, look, it's very safe. We've got a green screen. I showed my kids coming out. And they're holding drills and staplers. And they're climbing on ladders to hang the green screen in the back of the car. One guy comes out with like a giant saw.
You know? Now, in all your videos and stuff, you like to incorporate, you know, your kids in them and everything.
Yeah.
Do they really enjoy doing that with you?
Another challenge that I've had. And I think, I think what happened was that for a while, the kids were props, right? They were too little. They just do what I said and jump in the video. Then they started to get a little more self-conscious and they're, you know, now they need to be bought, you know, to get into a video. But the cool thing is now they're getting into that age of the sort of average YouTube viewer. So it's nice too, because I'm a little bit more impulse with, you know, what's hot for the 7 through 13 year old, you know, crowd. If you look at Annoying Orange, like Oh, yeah. That's the demo. My kids.
All right. Now, you've brought other people into it. Obviously, your wife on the channel, Wife of Nalt. What about Babysitter of Nalt, your first one? And I mean, I miss her.
Yeah, we just got a photo from Babysitter of Nalt. She's in California. We're going to see her in about a month. So we're still in touch with her. And we've had, of course, sequel Babysitters, but nobody's quite been there. And the backstory there was that we were literally at Applebee's, and my wife got recognized by this woman who was waiting the table, and she says, "Oh, you're Wife of Nalt's." And so, like, I'm thinking, this is pretty cool. The babysitter knows who I am, right? She didn't give a shit about Nalt's. She just wanted to be with Wife of Nalt's. Sorry, you're going to have to bleep that. She just wanted to be with Wife of Nalt's and the kids. She wasn't the least bit interested in Nalt's.
Now, are your kids eventually getting their own YouTube and starting their own little thing? Or
yeah. My son, I just got back from a business trip. My son showed me a video that he'd made. And the problem is they're all into music videos, so they're ripping, you know, copyrighted music. So it's not like they can become partner. I can live off their income. but they're so painstakingly, I mean, they will belabor it for hours and hours and hours as they put these stop action videos together. And it's so cool because I never wanted to be the one that would like push them on that. So every once in a while I'll walk by and go, yeah, it's good to see you're getting into the family business. A little wink.
So what?
Insert awkward pause.
Yes.
Yeah. Right.
I'm all side chat here.
Well, we talked about people taking this a little more corporate, and you notice that now everyone doesn't just have their main channel. They have their secondary channel and then their archive channel. How many channels do you have again?
I don't know. Like, literally, at one point, I asked YouTube if they could tally up how many blank of Nalt's there were, and it was like it was over 100. But the actual accounts that I own, maybe is, you know, closer to a dozen or two. But that's where I went wrong. I mean, when I started creating Uncle Nalt's, the goal was to be able to do less formal stuff and then use Nalt's for more packaged, you know, less frequent videos. But I think the whole way I hit into YouTube and sort of rose is because I created every day a video on Nalt's. Mm-hmm. And so that's like a very important recipe. And I think now people are starting to understand that if it's not every day, at least have a predictable programming schedule, because you can't just count on people seeing you in their subscriber page. They've got to know they can find you on a regular basis.
Right.
Right.
So what's the next blank of Nalt's?
Oh, you know, I think we're out. I think we're officially out of any of Nalt's. But check this out. Wife of Nalt's. You know, I've done a lot of sponsored videos. You talk about marketing. So I've done like lots of videos for brands. Well, Wife of Nalt's is in the middle of her first major sponsor. And we've been shooting these videos for consumer product, and she's tickled to death. And so stay tuned for that blatant sellout.
Definitely stay tuned for that and a little bit more about marketing with Nalt's. You'll have to come back on Saturday for that. Remember, you can find us on iTunes and subscribe to our RSS feed in the description below. Like I said, YouTube's the only place you can catch the full show, so come back on Saturday. While you're at it, find us on Twitter, Facebook, and circle us on Google+. And guess what, guys? We just launched a new website. You can find us there, www.thequadspot.com. Send your questions, comments, topic, and interview suggestions to quadspot@gmail.com. All those links are in the description. We'll see you guys Saturday, and we'll be back with Nalt's.